That was Presley Boulevard, Memphis, Tennessee. Let's go and have a look what it looks like circa 2011. Katie's Motel, it's gone by the wayside. That's where Elvis was buried initially. That's where the white hearses went in that day, August 1977, before he was moved out to Graceland, which is about 3 or 4 miles up the road here.
Houses, I don't understand. Which how much does the boulevard in?
Yeah. So Ben, why do you reckon, what's your thoughts on why this area has just gone to the dogs since Elvis died, for example, 34 years ago?
Just the whole inner city of Memphis has gotten like this. The poverty rate's pretty high. So, you know, when you have that, everything just goes down. People don't take care of stuff, they move away. So a lot of the money has moved that kind of out of Memphis. And, you know, it's just steady decline after that. When that happens, a lot of the businesses close. So then you've got all these empty buildings that aren't worth anything.
Yeah. Because people, you know, from the other side of the world, you mentioned Elvis Presley Boulevard, and it just sounds so, yeah, and it's anything but, unfortunately. Don't know what the king would make of it these days, that's for sure. Now up here on the left is where Glenn and I stayed in the first night we were here 10 years ago, and it's now gone. It's gone completely. At least they didn't leave it abandoned, I suppose. They did bulldoze it. We got hookers ringing us all night from other rooms, so we soon got out of there and went up to the Days Inn up here over the road from Graceland. And just a mile further up is Graceland Mansion. That's the gates. About 5:45 in the evening. The venerable Days Inn with its guitar-shaped swimming pool. We'll get a look at that soon enough. Another look. That doesn't look real nice, does it?
Well, you're getting right back to the...
So dead set in the middle of it, you got Graceland and all around it, yeah, it's the slums, as Tammy Bird calls it. When Elvis bought it, it was out in the middle of nowhere.
There was a movie theater back there for years, and we used to go to as kids, and this was a big shop.
It was, center. That was there, actually. The shopping center was there in 01. It's gone.
It's gone, because my grandparents lived just right back over behind those trees, and we used to walk up here to the shopping center and stuff when we were children.
When we first got to your place, Tammy was telling us about the mayor that ran the city dry of funds.
Yeah, he just, and they kept re-electing him, you know, and I guess once somebody's in office, it's so easy to keep them. People just recognize that name, especially in Memphis where illiteracy is pretty bad, that's just a name they recognize and they keep voting him in.
But he ran the city's coffers dry, and it's very hard to come back and reestablish things.
So much stuff went downhill, and it just never seems to come back. They let it go, and then nobody's, you know, going to buy that building or lease that building and take over. Everything grows up, and it just looks so bad.
That's a pity.
Plus, it forced so many people to move out of Memphis, and a lot of the income moved away. So the tax dollars lead away.
Down to places like Olive Branch and Germantown.
South Haven, Germantown, Cuyahoga, all the outlying cities, and now they're even moving some of them outside the whole county.
Yeah, okay.
Which, if you're Mississippi, obviously you're outside the county because you're another state. But
yeah,
even in Tennessee, they're moving outside Shelby County just because it's gotten so bad. The schools have gotten really bad.
And that's FedEx part of it anyway, which is...
That's the supply chain, which they kind of keep products for different companies and store them and then ship them when they're needed.
And you've worked with FedEx for 31 years.
31 years.
Tell me that story about when you jumped on a plane, a FedEx plane, to get a lift.
Yeah, FedEx jump seat, we could actually fly on our own planes to go somewhere, and one of the jump seat seats is in the cockpit. So it was a flight from California back to Memphis, which is a long flight, and I kind of dozed off and then woke up and looked up and all the pilots were asleep. I was like, dude, who's flying the plane? Who's watching the gauges?
So was that by design, or they weren't supposed to happen?
I don't know. I didn't really ask. They don't really like you asking them too many questions when you're up there, but kind of a surprise when you wake up and everybody else is asleep.
We've just crossed the state line to Mississippi, back down near Olive Branch, which is just near, just to the south, a few miles south of Graceland. There's the sheriff just going past us. There's two or three of them we've just seen. Yesterday we were doing 100 miles an hour up and down here. Ben said, oh, there won't be anyone around, and there wasn't, but there is today.
There's four, I think, that live in this neighborhood.
Well, we were a little bit farther out, where you're right between the two county lines, so we don't have too many out there.
You gotta know the area.
And there's the truck right there. Behind our good-looking Chevy Impala and the Chevy Corvette. Mm-hmm. I actually didn't like our Impala when I first picked it up, but I've come around to it. I do quite like it, and Ben reckons it's a good car. Mm-hmm. Don't you, Ben?
Yeah,
that's all right. Is there anything bad about them, anyway?
No, it's good.
Home sweet home, Tamer Bird.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, both of you. We had wonderful day.
We did too.
Enjoyable.
We enjoyed it.
Well, seeing as we're on a sort of nostalgic day, we're back at Walmart Olive Branch.
Right.
Where we were 9 years ago, we made a little film, didn't we?
Yes, we did. But I think it was raining that day, and today it's beautiful.
Yes, it was a bit later on in the year. We just got this little sticker on the video camera.
At least they didn't make it.
Last time we made the film and asked us to turn it off last time. Walmart.
You can have
anything you want
at Walmart.
Just like old times, Tammy Bird.
You can, but books, school paper,
anything you want. $15 pairs of Wrangler jeans, as we discovered the other day. All good. Tammy was just asking what we have comparably in Australia. It's Big W, it's called, and it's about a third of the size, the biggest one, of one of these. And yeah, you're right, knocked the nail right on the head. We just don't have the population. You just got people everywhere in this country. There's just so many of you. No wonder you're all so loud. You've got to talk so loud to be heard. Is that about right?
I'm loud to the country.
Hey, baby, what's up? We're on our way to Graceland. We're going to see the King Monday, August 29, 2011. We're going to see Graceland, and then we're going to go and see a few other music museums around town. Then we're going to head home for Tammy Bird's homemade barbecue ribs. So it should be a good day. It'll be a long one, but it'll be a good day.
Katy Perry and Adele were the night's big winners.
Yeah, there's a real shock, and you know, good on Adele for winning some stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, Katy Perry, she's done her thing, got it, you're cute, cotton candy and toys and bouncy stuff, and your knocker's out. Roger. Ken 4, next, it's been done.
And I'm sure there was a very moving tribute to Amy Winehouse at some point.
Yeah, that's right.
Breakfast Radio
Jazz
Memphis.
Bono is working.
$10 for parking out back, she said, anywhere out back. Now, we're not allowed to take the video camera in.
We always knew we weren't allowed to take the video camera in, so we'll take some stills and then we'll talk about it.
That's a shot of the best shot you can get with the video of the front of the house. Only still photography with no flashes. Well, we went in and did the tour, didn't we?
We saw everything.
I've got it. Barbara was saying, what was your impressions about?
I just think they've got it laid out so well. They've got everything. It's so beautifully put together.
Yeah, they do a really, really good job. I noticed some subtle differences from when I was here last 9 years ago. Only improvements though. And constantly shuffle the exhibitions around. But it's well worth a visit for anyone to come and have a look.
Very entertaining, very worthwhile doing.
And we're staying next door in a couple of days, so we'll come back for a bit more of a look at the front of the house and all that stuff then. Not the nicest part of town, but a very historic one. Well, we've just been through the Stax Records Museum. And it was wonderful. We weren't allowed to take video photography as we were at Graceland, as we're not going to be able to do at the Civil Rights Museum. Let's go and have a look at where Booker T. Jones lived. It's just around the corner. He was a local, like when he was a kid, and used to wander in here and bug them so much until they gave him an opportunity. And Aretha Franklin too, she grew up just in the next street. So it's a wonderful story. Stax Records on the corner of Macklemore and College. Shirley departed long ago, along with everyone else who had a business in this area. It's just part of what I was talking about yesterday. This is the old Lorraine Motel. This is the exact spot where Dr. Martin Luther King was assassinated on April the 4th, 1968. They've gutted the inside of the hotel and it's now the Civil Rights Museum. We're gonna go and pay our respects right now. We can't take the video camera in, and I don't know if we can get any still photos, but it is what it is.
there's the famous shots of Dr. King lying in the doorway and Jesse Jackson leaning over the railing, pointing back over this way to a building which is no longer there. Supposedly James Earl Ray was the gunman. Again, a lot of conspiracy theorists around with regards to his guilt or otherwise. Well, we've just come out of the museum. Hugely moving. They've made a lot of improvements and changes to it since I was here 10 years ago, including a film, a 32-minute film, which I have purchased on DVD, which is quite powerful. I was wrong about the building across the road where the shot's coming from being destroyed. Or not been in there any longer, because I've just stood at the window where the shots were fired. And that's it there, the little window to the right at the top. And that whole building has been gutted too, and it's got more museum exhibits and things in there, a lot more modern than the one behind me. And it's, the entry is underground there. It's quite sophisticated. I got to stand up there behind the balcony by myself for quite some time. And there's a window looking into the room, room 306. And obviously the windows you can see there out onto the balcony, just to soak it all in. Just a block or two away from the Lorraine Motel, it's the big FedEx Forum, which I'm not sure what it is exactly. I know my brother Matt will know. We're in deep in downtown. That's Beale Street just there. The smell of barbecue is around everywhere. The other thing I noticed is this is peak hour. This is 4:45 on a Monday afternoon, and there's just nothing happening because there's just no one around. All the infrastructure and all the business has gone out of Memphis itself. That's Beale Street up there, where we were yesterday. Peabody Hotel, the famous Peabody, and we're now on the corner of Union and something or other, and we're looking for Sun Studios, which is up here, I'm pretty sure, from memory. It's been 9 years though, and we've found already on this trip that my memory after 9 years ain't as flash as I thought it might be. Well, we've been walking in Memphis, about 10 feet off of Beale, and up onto Union Avenue. Been up to the gates of Graceland and we've walked right through. Yes, you get the idea, now we're at Sun Studios.
So this is the room I've been telling you about. Of course, you walk in here, it's just a little tiny place, isn't it? But truly, this is the room that many people would tell you that rock and roll music was actually created where you're standing. So that is pretty incredible when you think about that, of course, because it means, you know, among other things, this little room here changed the entire world with the music that came out of this place. So that is incredible. But, you know, I got something else to tell you, a little incredible, hard to believe. It's about that first recording of Elvis I played for you upstairs. Remember I told you that Marion Kiesker out there made it, right? Luckily, she also saved a copy of that recording because, you know, she felt, here's something a little special, right? So she plays it for Sam Phillips. And guess what? Sam, he hears that. He was not interested in recording Elvis Presley. And that was because, you know, really he was recording the blues. And that was a pop song. He wasn't interested in pop music. This means, ultimately, Elvis would have to wait over a year before he was invited back in this room to make a real recording. That was mainly due to Marion Kiesker. But, you know, Elvis didn't have a band, So Sam Phillips introduced them to these two other musicians up there. Scotty Moore on the guitar, Bill Black on the bass. That's who you saw on that television show up there with Elvis. They played mostly on some of the country music that was recorded in here. But it was July 5th, 1954. That's when they were all in here together. Bill Black, that's actually where he stood right there with the double bass he played. That always put the guitar player on the other side over there. But Elvis Presley, let me show you, right there on that spot. That is where he would have actually stood when he recorded in this room, as well as these other great vocalists. That's where they figured out the best acoustics were for that. Now here's a man who originally was a door-to-door salesman in Memphis, but he ended up becoming one of Sun's biggest stars. He's sitting right over there, later known as the Man in Black, Johnny Cash. Also, first recordings made right here in this room, Folsom Prison Blues, among so many other great ones, including his first number one record, I Walk the Line.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tide that's by.
Can't forget the man Elvis called his favorite singer back there with those sunglasses on, Roy Orbison, and this was his first Sun record. That was 1956, which also is going to bring us to one of the greatest moments in the history of rock and roll music. It also happened that year right here in this room by a complete coincidence. We had in here at the same time Elvis Presley, Carl Perkins, Johnny Cash, and a new piano player in town named Jerry Lee Lewis. They were all here together, and of course, there we have them in that famous photograph, and that is known as the Million Dollar Quartet. And what happened is they just started singing, they started playing all these songs together, as musicians will do, and luckily for us, that was recorded. The thing you really have to keep in mind here is that this room we're in right now, it's not a museum. You know, this is not only about what happened in the past, because today we still continue to be a functioning recording studio as well.
Well, we've enjoyed our tour of Sun Studios, and now it's time to head on up Union Avenue down the 51 Elvis Presley Boulevard and home to Olive Branch, Mississippi. Let's go.
You don't really hear about it.
It's the front office.
But there were quite a few, actually. The biggest one was a woman named Barbara Pittman. She was like the biggest female artist, but unfortunately, Sam didn't really know what to do, didn't know how to produce female artists.
All right, we've had another King Day.
We did.
Literally King Day today. Time to head on back. And a push, that's Samson. That's Samson. He got a mention in the film 10 years ago, but we didn't get him on video. That's Tom.
Tom?
Tom and Jerry's his brother.
Hi, Jerry.
That's Jerry. Oh, not to be left out.
Yeah, if I pet one, I have to pet the other.
And here comes Sam. He's a bit more reserved, is Sam. He's 3 years older. He's 11.
He's 11, they're 8, and I call him my firstborn. He's like a Maine coon.
Yeah.
Isn't that the Maine?
Look at the mane on him.
He just has a lot of hair.
He's very distinctive. It's like, what's the lion in The Lion King?
Simba.
Simba.
When Simba was a baby.
Yeah, okay.
He looked a lot like that.
I've never seen that film, and I've got to sit down and watch it with my niece Jessica, don't I?
That's right.
Yeah, very pleasant out here. This time in the morning in Olive Branch, Mississippi, it's 7:30, tail end of summer, and it's just beautiful. The birds are singing and they're fluttering around. And we've got to go to Nashville, so yes. I better go and get dressed because I'm driving.
Let's do it.
And that's what I do.
Okay, that's what you do. And I'm going with you.
Yes, you are.
Come on.